In the aftermarket, when it comes to tuning, typically what we're trying to do is increase our power and our torque values. And as we've gone through this course, you've seen that the cam control, or particularly continuously variable cam control, has a large influence over our power and torque curve. An aspect though that's easy to lose track of is that as we're adjusting our cam timing, this will also in turn influence our tailpipe emissions. And increasingly, emissions has become more and more of a stumbling block for tuners in the aftermarket, and particularly if you live in a country where emission standards need to be adhered to, making sure that your tune does meet the legislation is going to be a big factor. Otherwise, realistically, it doesn't matter how much power and torque you are making. If your car's not emissions legal, it's not going to make it onto the road. So in this module, we're going to have a look at how the cam timing influences our engine torque as well as our emissions. To do this, we have got a 5-gas analyzer hooked up to our Subaru STI. For the purposes of this demonstration, we are using the Haltech Elite software. And while there will be variations, of course, between different software packages, essentially the relationship between our cam tuning and our emissions is going to remain the same. Now, with the 5-gas analyzer, as its name implies, we are analyzing a variety of different components of the tailpipe emissions. Just to make things really simple for our demonstration today, we're going to be focusing on just one of those metrics, which is our NOx, or oxides of nitrogen output, measured in parts per million. So just to have got some insight into how this is going to go, let's just jump quickly into our Haltech ESP tuning software, and we'll go through some of the aspects that we will be adjusting. Now, for a start here, we are on our cam tuning tab, and this is our cam timing table for our intake cam. While the STI that we are tuning has quad variable cam control, so both the intake and the exhaust cams are variable, again, for simplicity here, we're going to be focusing on just our intake cam. Of course, the exhaust cam has as much influence, or has also some influence over the emissions, but this should be enough to give you a bit of a guide as to how the emissions is affected by our cam tuning anyway. So the area I've just highlighted in the table there, we can see that we've got a range of cells that I have set to zero. So for our test, what we're going to be doing is focusing on this cell here, minus 20 kPa, 3000 RPM. The reason that I have also highlighted the cells surrounding that is that this way, setting all of the cells to the same value just makes sure that we aren't going to have interpolation affecting our results. Now, of course, cam timing is not the only aspect that influences our tailpipe emissions. Air fuel ratio will be another big driver in that. So for the purposes of this experiment, we really want to make sure that as many of our operating parameters as possible are held steady, so that we're really only influencing the emissions with our cam timing. To help us with this, we are running the Elite 2500 ECU in closed loop mode. And here we can see the left-hand side, we've got our wideband air fuel ratio, our measured air fuel ratio, and beside this we've got our short-term fuel trim from our closed loop. And this is actually not active right now at idle, but as we come up to our 3000 RPM minus 20 kPa site, we're going to see that short-term fuel trim start moving around. And what it's going to do is just make adjustments as I move the cam timing so that the air fuel ratio always tracks stoichiometric, or 14.7:1 for the pump gas we are running. Another consideration here is our ignition timing, and we're just going to be leaving this static at a fixed value so that, again, we're trying to only influence our cam timing as we go through this particular test. Up here, we will be able to view our cam timing along with our cam target. In a moment, you can see the top value that's moving around. That's our current cam angle, sitting about 1 degree. Our cam target at the moment sitting at zero, and that will also be tracked in real time using our time graph here on the left-hand side. Now, in order to track what's going on, let's head over to our dyno and we'll see how our test is set up. Alright, so what we've got here is a torque optimization test, and I often use this feature on our mainline dyno to help optimize our ignition timing, but it can be used for a variety of other aspects as well. On the left hand axis here, we've got our torque being measured by the dyno in pound foot. Along the horizontal axis here, we can see that we've got our inlet cam angle that's being sent to the dyno from the Haltech Elite ECU via a CAN communication bus. On the right hand side, we've got our NOx or oxides of nitrogen output there between 0 and 4,000. And over on the right-hand side, we can see here at idle at the moment, we've got a measurement of our oxides of nitrogen of about 500 parts per million. So what we'll do now is get the engine up and running. We'll allow our NOx value to stabilize and we can get our test started. Just before we start the test, I'll just explain how I'm going to do this. The five gas analyzer in particular does have a reasonable amount of latency before the reading will update. So it's not instantaneous like we'd see from the likes of our wideband air fuel ratio meter. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to step our cam timing in 2 degree increments. And each time I make a step change, I'm going to allow about 5 or 6 seconds for our NOx reading to update. So we're going to speed this process up because otherwise it's going to take a little while to do. You'll see the two graphs being updated as we go through the test. We'll swing the cam timing from 0 through to 50 degrees, and once we've got those two graphs up, we'll be able to talk about the results. You will notice as these graphs develop that they are a little bit erratic. There's a little bit of noise in these graphs, so we need to do a little bit of mental smoothing, but we can talk about that once the test is complete. Alright, so we'll just make sure that we are stable in the center of our cell here, and we'll allow our NOx value to stabilize, and we'll get our test underway. Alright, so we've got our test complete there, and again, as I mentioned, the two graphs we've drawn have got a little bit of noise associated with them, but we do see some pretty clear trends, so it's not very difficult to do a little bit of mental smoothing around those graphs. First of all, looking at our red graph, which is our torque, we can see with 0 degrees advance, we were sitting at around about 300 pound foot of torque. We've seen a small increase there. We've gone from 300 up to around about 330 pound foot. We're actually pretty flat there from about 10 degrees of cam timing all the way through to about 35 degrees. The dyno has shown us that if we want to split hairs, the peak value there occurred with a cam advance of 26.2 degrees for that particular cell. Looking at our yellow graph for our oxides of nitrogen though, we can see at the start of the test we're sitting, uses the right graph I should point out here, we're sitting at around about 3,200, maybe 3,300 parts per million. As we begin advancing the cam, we actually see that initially that value does increase. We peak here at around about 15 degrees of advance, pretty close to about 3,400, 3,500 parts per million. And we can see that as we continue to advance the cam here, we can see that our oxides of nitrogen values actually drop, and by the time we're at 50 degrees maximum advance, we'd drop down to about 2300 parts per million. So what this means is that if we look at our maximum and our minimum values, we are looking at about a 800 part per million decrease by adjusting our cam timing. Now obviously this does to a degree come at the expense of some of our torque. Looking at the point where we saw minimal NOx emissions is at 50 degrees cam advance, and here we can see that our torque has dropped back down to around about 310 pound foot. So we've sacrificed 20 pound foot of torque there to improve our oxides of nitrogen emissions at the tailpipe. And realistically, this is something you need to factor into your tuning if you are going to try and meet emissions standards. The decision as to what you're aiming for, whether you're looking at peak power, peak torque, or you're looking for minimal tailpipe emissions, or a balance of those aspects, really just comes down to the task you're trying to complete. This module is simply here to show you that relationship. It's certainly not supposed to be an all-encompassing lesson on emissions, because it is a very complex topic. Now here we have only looked at the intake cam. As I mentioned, we've got the ability to move the exhaust cam as well, and of course this will influence the emissions further. In particular, when we have a variable intake and exhaust cam control, we've got the ability to essentially create internal EGR, or exhaust gas recirculation. That's one of the techniques that OE manufacturers use to reduce oxides of nitrogen emissions at the tailpipe. up and in fact emissions in general. The idea here is that we're purposely making sure that there is some exhaust gas left over inside the cylinder for the new intake charge. And what that's going to do is we've got this inert gas, the exhaust gas that's remaining, that's not obviously going to combust. It's inert, as its name implies, that it's not taking part in the combustion process. But the important part here from an emissions standpoint is that it is displacing some of the volume of fresh air and fuel charge that now can't fit into the cylinder. So we're essentially purposely decreasing the cylinder fill. This in turn is the same as essentially reducing our volumetric efficiency. It also creates a smaller combustion event, and oxides of nitrogen in particular are driven by the combustion temperature. So if we can lower our combustion temperature, then this in turn will drive our NOx values lower. So there you go, just a little bit of insight into the emissions controls that we have at our fingertips with continuously variable cam control. From here though, it's up to you to apply these lessons, so make sure that you are remaining legal for wherever in the world you're specifically tuning. That was just one of the modules taken from our cam control tuning course. If you're tuning an engine that uses continuously variable cam control, switch cam control, or you've fitted vernier adjustable cam gears to your engine, this course is perfect for you. You'll learn about the fundamentals of camshaft operation, and you'll see how the valve timing affects performance, economy, and emissions with dyno demonstrations. You'll also learn some general guidelines for the ideal valve timing events for optimizing both low and high RPM performance. If you'd like to find out more about this course, click the link for more information.